I think we're on. Oh, no. Okay. Hi. Welcome, everybody, on live stream to Firebaugh Faith Fellowship. I don't do this all the time, so excuse me. But welcome, and you're going to enjoy today's service. Amen. You may be seated. I get the privilege to go ahead and take up offering. I don't do this all the time, so there's a lot of stuff inside me that I want to give, so I'm trying to categorize it and make it beneficial for you. So God gave me a route to go for the offering. I don't want to take up too much time because I got a lot here that I could say, but I'm going to make it brief, and I pray that it's going to help you. Anytime that we get up or I get up, I'm not saying it to be boastful. I'm not saying it to bring attention to myself or anything, but from the experiences and things that I've done throughout my small life, you know, I'm only 39. I know I look 25, but hey, but 39 years isn't very long. It doesn't seem that way, at least. And so God's taught me quite a bit over that years, but I'm not arrived just yet. And so what I do know I'd like to share with you guys to help you grow into a different area. And maybe you supersede what I know, or maybe God's got you in a different path. That's all good and well. So we could use what we have and sharpen each other to make us better believers, better Christians, and grow in the things of God. We're not here to criticize. We're not here to bring you down, but we're here to build each other up. Amen. So that's where my heart is when I come and give you this offering message. Amen. So I want to start off in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 19. So let's turn there. I got my notes in here. I just got to find them. Let's read. Actually, just a couple sentences, really. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the best of the land. Just like the song says, we're living in the overflow, right? But what gets us there in the overflow? You got to ask yourself that question. The blessing doesn't come accidentally. Curses don't come accidentally. You don't get in trouble accidentally. I remember when I was a young man, I used to hang out with the wrong crowd. I think what it was people hung out with me, and I was the wrong crowd, is what it was. And so I knew what we were doing. You know, I knew we were doing wrong, but we were excited to do those wrong things, and we weighed the consequences. We said, okay, is this worth getting spanked tonight? We said, yeah, it's worth it. And so we would do it. So we got to, but, you know, I grew up from that. So we need to be willing and obedient. If you're willing and obedient, you won't get in trouble. You won't get set down, or you won't get talked to for us that work for somebody. You won't get terminated, fired, or set down from your position and someone else supersedes you. As believers, we should be the one superseding in the business. We should be the one accomplishing things and be the problem solver, just like Joshua. No, Joseph, sorry, Joseph. He was a problem solver. He was in prison, and he revealed the dream of the king, and he did all sorts of stuff that God, he wasn't being a problem. He was being a problem solver. And as a business owner, I feel like God sometimes, because what happens is, not saying I am, but I see it in a different perspective than employees. Because an employee sometimes wants to come to work for a paycheck. That's all they really are concerned about. But as a business owner, there's a different responsibility on my shoulders that I have to make sure that a customer is being satisfied by our work ethic. And so what takes place is I see my staff and I say, hey, I think this person could do better. I think by a little bit of push or a little bit of nudge, they'll be able to be a better employee or better at what they do. And I would take them to the side and say, hey, look, if you do this, I will do this. Or I will pay for this so you get a little bit of education so you could achieve this and make more money. And so sometimes that's a good thing, and that's what God does with us. He says, hey, if you're obedient and do this, you're going to eat the good of the land. If you take that step of faith, I will meet you there. But God has want us to do it. We're not children where we are, like Daniel was saying, you know, when we're young kids, we're told what to do all the time. But once we become mature, we just know what to do. by way of the Holy Spirit. We learn how to be skillful with the Holy Spirit, and we make decisions based on what we know. And we may make some mistakes, but we know how to correct them pretty quick. From a child, you know, they don't know why they're getting in trouble. They're just making mistakes. So it takes an adult that knows, which in this case, God, he knows, the Holy Spirit knows, he's the one correcting us. So with all that said right there is, I give those an opportunity, and that's what God gives us all the time, is opportunities to be a blessing, okay? But it's our choice to take those opportunities. They're never forced upon you. They're never demanding of us, but it's our choice. And I remember as a young adult being challenged several times by pastors, hey, we need, you know, not necessarily directly, but saying, hey, if you do this, God will bless you. Everything you do sees as seed, and God's going to reward that. And at first, I didn't understand that. I just knew, okay, my pastor knows something here. My man of God, my woman of God knows something here. So I'm going to just do what they say. And I didn't know if it was right or wrong. I just knew it was right in here. By way of the Holy Spirit, I knew it was right. There was no red flags. I just knew to go. Just do it. Like Daniel says, if you don't have anything stopping you, that was awesome. Just do it, you know, because that's the peace of God. Or was that pastor that said that? I get those confused because prayer and the messages have been mingling pretty good. So, but I started doing that at a young age. And God's been blessing me everything I do. Everything I do, I put my hands to do is prospering. And that's what God wants for all of us, is anything that you put your hands to do will prosper, but it has to start with your obedience. And so what I was saying about the employees is I see a few things when I tell them this. So I want you to write these down because these are very important. And this could be, if you're an employee, this will benefit you guys, okay? Because I'm seeing this as a perspective from an employer. So trust me, if you do this, your employer is going to notice, okay? And this is not to get brownie points or anything, but it's just to make you a better Christian. And this is for everyday life, okay? Can't find my notes. Where did I put it? Oh, right there in front of me. Okay. So, first of all, God is into progression, not stagnation. Okay, if you're going to achieve anything, you got to progress. You got to have movement. You can't just assume that you're going to get a raise or God's going to bless your hands when you're not doing anything and just by just sitting there and praying all day, which, you know, like Daniel said and Pastor Nancy said, prayer's good, but there's a time to act. When you know to act and when you know that you got to do something in order to get where you need to go, you just got to do it, okay? The other thing is be obedient to what God tells you. God's not going to tell you sometimes what he's telling me or what he's telling your friend, your mother, your spouse. He might be telling you to do something specifically that's going to benefit you. You just got to be obedient with that, amen? That's where it starts. Another thing that I was taught growing up, and I use this still today, is be a problem solver, not the problem. A lot of times I see employees, instead of them solving problems, they're becoming a problem, and that's not beneficial. And that's also for the kingdom of God. God loves you. He wants you to be blessed, just like I want my employees to succeed and achieve better for their life. But we got to be the problem solvers. God's asking us. He's not here on this earth. We are. By way of the Holy Spirit, we are led by him, and we got to do it. We got to do the work. Amen? So if you want to be blessed, be the problem solver, not the problem. Look for the opportunities outside of your regular routine of giving. That's another thing. If you really, you know, we know to give, tithe, offering, first fruits. Those are the three basic things we know, but there's more just to that. Just like Reverend Jerry Savelle, what did he say? Sometimes just do a shock and awe, a surprise giving, okay? Something that's going to move someone else, not because it moves you sometimes, but because you want to be a blessing to somebody. You want to, if you see a need in someone's life, that's what God calls us to do, is to help bring our brothers and sisters. I tell you what blessed me growing up is My car used to run out of gas, and I used to drive by faith, and I'm pretty sure some of you guys done. And you know, at that time, that's how my faith was. It's like, hey, I'm going to church. I'm going somewhere. I might not have any gas in my tank, but I'm gonna try to get there. And sometimes I didn't make it. You know, and so I would call Jacob, and I'd say, hey, brother, could you help me out? Come and get me. So he would come. I remember we had one church conference, I think, here, and it was like 10 minutes till, and he came all the way down to Nice Avenue to come and pick me up just to get here, and that was my beginning days. And that happened a few times, and finally, I was told, hey, man, you got a plan. I'm like, I am, man. This is my faith level. I don't have the money for gas right now. I'm just doing what I know to do. I'm putting momentum. You know, I got here. I might have been a little late, but I got here. So my heart was right, okay? And sometimes because your heart's right doesn't mean you're doing right, okay? That's another thing. I don't know if I could explain that very well. Your intentions are good, but you're really not doing right. Like Daniel said, is when you, you know, you might be called to pray, that's a good thing, but it might not be for right now, okay? Time's to act right now, the time's to act, amen? So look for opportunities outside of your regular routine of giving, and then also stand in faith. You got to stand in faith and then put momentum to it. Amen. Let's see. And then when you're in the middle of standing in faith, you got to give God all the glory. You got to give him all the praise. And then when God starts blessing your hands, you got to not forget who gave you the power to get that wealth. Because he's the one that blessed you, not your skill level, even though you have some. And you know, you guys can earn money by doing that. But God's blessing your hands is where it's coming from. He's giving you a skill. He's giving you a talent to use for the good of the kingdom. And you will be blessed because of it. God said he will empower you to prosper and in everything you put your hands to do. In everything. That's a promise. Okay? If you're not being blessed in what you do, maybe it's not what you're supposed to do. You got to check. You got to do evaluation. Let's go to Matthew 25, and I'm not going to read all this because this is going to take a long time, but I'm just going to paraphrase it and maybe read a couple of the scriptures out here. Matthew 25, verse 15. We'll start there. It says, to one he gave five talents. Actually, I'm going to just paraphrase this because it's a long chapter. But we all know this probably is the man with the talents, he dispersed it amongst three people. He gave one five, I think one two and one. Okay? So the whole gist of it is about the kingdom of God and souls. But we're going to use this for offering time and also your progression. Okay, so we could apply this. This is what I apply to my personal life is I see this, and I don't want to be the one with the one talent where something's given to me, and I'm not doing anything with it. I sit on it and hope that my boss, well, at that time I was an employee, but I was hoping that I could make my boss proud, so to speak, of what I'm doing for him and the kingdom, or not the kingdom, but his business. I'm doing Christianese here. But you know, everything I learned here at church, I applied to my personal life, my business life, and I achieved what I did because of the obedience and then also what scripture taught me. And so with the man with the five talents, what did he do? He immediately, which in verse, let's see, I think it was verse 16. Yeah, so the one who had received the five talents went at once. So that's a key thing right there. At once, what did he do? He took off. And he said, I know what to do with this. So that tells me the guy that took the five talents, he was skillful. He's already been proven by the master. The master saw the spirit that he had that, hey, this guy, I could trust him with a lot right now. And I know he's going to do something with it. And that's what, you know, God is looking for. And that's what an employer is looking for is an employee that, hey, could I trust this guy to do this? Is God's asking us, could he trust you to do this? Or are you just going to sit down with it? And so that's what the first man did. And then, you know, the middle one, he did good too. He went out and invested as well. But the last one, so there's a big comparison with the first guy and the last guy. The first guy, he immediately took off and invested. And that's what God's asking us to do. He wants us to invest in the kingdom so heartedly that he's going to prove to you that he's going to bless your hands. And that's exactly what happened with the man with the five talents. When the master got back, he said, good and faithful servant. And then what did he do? He blessed him with even more, twice as much. And then the one that didn't, he called them unworthy, unfaithful servant. And that's where God doesn't want us. He doesn't want us sitting on what we have. He wants us to be a blessing, sow the seed, and be obedient, and we'll eat the good of the land. Amen? Let me make sure I am done. So I hope that helped you. So in Luke 6:38, it says, given it shall be given. Pressed down, shaken together, running over, will men pour into your bosom. More than what you can contain. Amen? You may not be at levels of others, but if you want to get there, it is not a bad idea to copy what they do as examples. Even Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. You know, I remember telling Pastor right here, and I probably said this last time I remember, I said, Pastor, I'm going to follow you as long as you follow Christ, because I saw that scripture, and I wanted to apply that. So, you know, sometimes you might say in yourself, hey, I'm not going to, I'm only going to do this much. But God's saying, hey, stretch yourself, challenge yourself, motivate yourself. You may not have $100, but are you willing to give it if you were to have it? Pastor shared many examples where they didn't have the money, $1,000, I think it was, $1,000 offering. They vowed it. And shortly, just because of their faithfulness and obedience with the little things, it came in immediately. A lot of things that, this is actually, I missed a couple things I want to share too with you, and then I'll close with this. I noticed when, these are a few things that, I thought I put them in here. I'll remember them though. These are the things that hold people back from giving, okay? And this is what holds people back from being a blessing as well, because of, first of all, their disobedience. But I notice when I give people a opportunity to move up, there's a couple things I see in their, just by their expression. One is fear of the promotion, because obviously it comes with more responsibility. So the responsibility puts them in fear. The other thing is that they don't want to be challenged. They're satisfied where they are. So, but they want more. They don't want to do more, but they want more. So which one is God going to use? Is the question to ask yourself. Is he going to use the one that is willing to take up the obedience and sow the seed and reap, or the one that's just going to sit back? Amen? So with that said, let's go ahead and be a blessing. And see this as an opportunity for your life. You know, just like we invest in investments, that's what you're doing here. You're investing in your future, because God is going to bless your hands. Amen? Amen. I don't know if we got any music today. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity to give to the kingdom. We thank you that we count it as a privilege and honor to be a blessing to your kingdom, Father. And we know, Father, that we're giving with our heart, and that our seed is going to grow and be fruitful for our lives, Father, so we could be more of a blessing. And I thank you. We take up the challenge. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Just stay standing. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this night that we get to come together as the body of Christ of this local church, Father. I thank you, Lord. We acknowledge that you are our God, that you are our Savior, you are our healer, you are our provider, you are our safe place. We thank you for all that you are to us, Lord. We are mindful of how good you are, how faithful you are, and we recognize you as our Lord. We recognize you as the one who will forever reign. No one and nothing can take you off of that throne. And so we thank you, Lord, that because you are on that throne and you gave us all authority here on earth, if no one and nothing can take you off of your throne, then no one or nothing except ourselves can take our authority. Because you gave us that authority on this earth. You gave us that authority. And so we choose, Lord, to be good stewards of it. And so tonight, Father, we come to hear your word. We come to be changed by your word. We come to act, not just to receive, but to act, Father, because we know that faith is not complete until it has legs, until it acts. So we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and be seated. We know that almost everybody is, including our pastors, they are at the prayer conference in Marietta. If you've been watching, they've been so good so far. And I know they're going to continue on being good. You never turn it on and be disappointed. So good. And it's just, she kind of went on the same vein that she taught here last night about, not confidence, condemnation, the opposite, condemnation. And it's just things are lining up. And I know God is, like Pastor said to us, He's setting us up for something. God is. Amen. So tonight, let me see, where do I want to start? I want to start by just saying these couple of things or a few things that our pastor said on Sunday morning. Yes, he taught Sunday morning. He said, don't stay in the place of delay. Really, that service to me was a challenging service. Not a challenging, like, oh, this is so hard to receive, but it was like God challenging us. Like, are you willing to come for what I have for you? Because he was challenging us about more, right? Do you guys remember that? He kept saying, well, I thought we were giving enough. And what did he go? No. Or oh, I thought we were faithful enough. No. I thought we've been praying enough. No. And, you know, I love that because it's so easy to become so comfortable. I, you know, in my own children, if I see them just getting comfortable, even during summer vacations, like, let's do something. Let's not just stay, you know, in our jammies till noon, or let's not just, even though I just told Bianca today, I was like, man, today I didn't get in the shower till like 1 o'clock. That's because I was busy. I was like getting stuff done. But let's, you know, I love being challenged. And that's what that service felt like a challenge. Like, oh, you know, sometimes we feel so good about ourselves. Like, oh, and not that God is like saying, no, you're not good enough. But with God, there is always more. He always wants to take us to more places. And so Pastor said that, don't stay in the place of delay. He said, with change comes stretching and doors of opportunity. And I know he was also quoting Pastor Nancy with some of these. So with change comes stretching and doors of opportunity. Sometimes we can, you know, be stretched and we feel like, oh, this is so uncomfortable. And we think when Pastor, like from that service, if we left thinking, man, I'm going to have less than because I got to obey. I'm going to give more. I'll give towards the building fund. I'll give more. But man, that means that project I wanted to get done, it's not going to get done. That means that car I wanted to get done, it's not going to get done. That means that home we want to get into, probably not going to get into it because, you know, we're going to give because we're being challenged. We're going to be stretched. But now it means we're going to have less than. That's not how we should have left the building. We should have left thinking, you know what? If God is stretching me just like a rubber band, if you take a rubber band, you know, those real thick ones, they're thick, right? And you stretch it. Does it get thinner? Yes. But what happens? It's able to hold more, right? It's able to hold more continents. There's more flexibility in that to capture more. So let's not think, oh, our pastor's stretching us. That means my household's going to do with less than. Not my household. That means that we will, as we obey that challenge of more, that's what I hear, more, more, more. That's wonderful. I will take that challenge. Here's more. But I know that God is not just going to leave us at less than, because that's not my God. That's not, he has never left me with less than. Through my whole Christian life, he has always been the God of more than enough. And I'm not just talking about financially. I'm just talking about everything, more than enough. Time. I will not do with less time. Right? Sometimes we feel like more faithful. What do you want us to do? We have so much time. I know that I'll be blessed with more time to get the things done that I need to get done. And that goes for everything, right? If he requires more of us, he's not going to leave us with less than. He's taking us into more, just like a rubber band. It holds more. And then the last thing that I wrote down of that I wanted to mention that he said, the door of opportunity calls for action. Calls for action. Action, action. That's a verb. I love teaching the guy. That's my new favorite subject is language, because I understand it now. I know English now. Took me 20 years, but I know English. I love the language now. I was like, oh, okay, it makes sense, and, you know, and all this stuff. But, you know, that word action, if we're going to take that challenge, you know, we can answer the call of more and still not receive what God has for us because we're just doing it. Okay, I'll give more. Let me stretch. But we feel like we're being robbed. We feel put out. So is that the word? Put out, like you're putting me on the spot, and so now I have less than, like it's an inconvenience. So that there's no action in that. It's just we're giving, we are acting in it, but it's not out of a right heart. It's like Tomas said, you can do the right things, but from a wrong place, like you're just in fear. Well, I don't want to be the one not giving more. I don't want to be the one not giving towards the building fund. I don't want to be the one not coming to prayers, but I'll come, but our heart is not in it. Therefore, there's no action, right? So are the door of opportunity calls for action. I just want to read those really fast before I started. Let's go to Romans 4:18. I'm already there. This is a very short summary of Abraham. And sometimes when we read the Bible, all the time actually when we read the Bible, we see the faith journeys. That's kind of what I'm going to talk about, faith journey. We see their faith journey unfolding from beginning to end, but we get to see something that they did not see when they got the instruction or the command of the Lord, right? Or that promise, that end result, like when God said to Moses, when God said to Joshua, when God said to Abraham, he said things to them. And we can flip through the pages and see the end result, that it's good. But they didn't know that. I mean, they knew, they trusted God, but they weren't able to flip through the pages and say, okay, it's going to be good, so I'll follow God, right? So we get the advantage of seeing their faith journey from hearing the instructions, the commands of the Lord, to acting on them. They all had some obstacles, right? Not one story in the Bible was there not an obstacle through a command, right? He gave a command, and surely there was, you know, an obstacle of some shape or form. But we get to see the end result, that it was a good end result. But sometimes, you know, I like to put myself in their shoes. Like, I love imagining. I have a lively imagination. And I just like to pretend, oh, my gosh, God is asking me to leave. I'm not saying God's telling me to leave. I'm talking about for Abraham. Leave my family. Leave my home that I'm comfortable in. Leave everything and go where? Where am I going? Like, could you imagine God's telling you to just come? To go? So let's read here, Romans 4:18. Who against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he promised, he was also able to perform. So we see a very quick summary of Abraham's journey here in the New Testament. But like I said, there was many things that Abraham had to get through. We know he made mistakes. We know that he had to go through things. It was a journey. And that's what a faith journey is. There were things that Abraham had to walk out step by step, even those mistakes that he made along the way, right? But he had to walk them through. So it's not like this instant, you know, God said you're going to be in a house and you're going to wake up and you're in that house. Or God said he has a business for you and you wake up and it's like a success overnight. There is a process. And Pastor Ramos said that today. He said how in the things that he's been believing for in the past, how he is so glad. He said it like this. I'm so thankful that it was an instant. And you kind of wonder, like, really? But I understand what he means. Because if it was instant, there would be no growth. If I came to church when I was 16, 17, If I would have been where I am today at the age of 19, just 3 years later, I would not have made it. There would have been no growth. And I'm not saying that we learn through hardship. No, but we learn by those faith steps, hearing from God, renewing our minds, acting on what we heard, making the mistakes. I've made mistakes. Have you made mistakes? We've all made mistakes. And God showed me, you know, and the mercy of God that doesn't just leave you in your mistake, but he doesn't just get you out of it and, you know, cleans you up. He makes you new and he starts you over and he gets you through. And all that whole journey, it's not to look down upon like, oh, it's a journey, you know, because journey signifies a long process. And I plan on being on this earth for a very long time. So there's all, unless the Lord comes back. So there's obviously still so much more, right? That say 50 years from now, that God's not just going to drop in my lap right now, because I'm probably not ready for it, right? There's still more to develop. There's more to grow. And so if you're new, if you just got born again, maybe you're watching or you're here, don't get discouraged in those days of small beginnings. Those days where you're hearing so much faith, so much abundance, so much like, you know, about how big God is, and you see, well, I'm here. Don't let the devil discourage you with that, because he's not leaving you there. God doesn't show us more to leave us with less. Amen. So we have to be willing to go on this journey called faith and be willing to not just, you know, like drag our feet and okay, but to be working in this journey. It's a journey. The faith walk is a walk of work. It's a walk of action. It's not a walk of, well, it's just going to, you know, fall on me or whatever. You know, pastors call me their daughter, and I don't see that as, how do I say it? It's two ways. I don't see it as I'm above now, and I don't see it as I don't deserve it. Do you know what I'm saying? I receive it fully. And that was hard for me in the beginning. And what I realize now is that I didn't know it then, but when they adopted me, so to speak, I got more, there's responsibilities to that. I don't, and I put responsibilities on my children. Don't act that way. People are watching you. Not that we just watch each other, but, you know, you represent our pastors. You represent your papa and your nana. When we go places, when you wear your Faith Academy uniform and you know, people ask you about it, you speak, you talk to them the right way, because you represent. Right? So that's the way I see it, is I represent my pastors. When I'm standing here, I don't see it as, oh, you know, I'm above or anything. I see it as I represent them. They are the ones that entrusted me with tonight, so I want to be responsible for it. I'm not sure why I said that. Because we're responsibility, the faith journey. And it's like he said a lot of what I had, You can want more. No one's going to stop you. You can want as much as you want, but that doesn't mean you're going to get it. I tell my kids that all the time. You know, they'll come to me. I want this. I want that. I go, that's wonderful. You can want whatever you want. I will never tell you, no, you can't have that, but you need to stretch your faith. You need to use your faith. You know, she knows, she understands faith. We're still teaching Ethan, faith, because he'll be like, well, it didn't happen. Well, I don't hear you confessing it anymore. What have you sown? Have you given away a toy? So teaching them that the same way that God teaches us, that we can't just give up on our faith, that faith isn't just, I want and I get, I want and I get. There's work, right? With more blessings come more responsibilities. Just like in a job, like he said, you get promoted. That doesn't mean you just get a bigger check. I understand that, because I remember when he took over the business and not seeing him day after day after day. The first year of Ethan's life, he hardly saw his dad, because that was the year that he took over. And it was, yeah, it was a bigger check, but it was also, are we going to get through this without crumbling and crying, and oh, my husband's not home, and I have a newborn, and oh my God, this is too hard, I don't think we can do this, and you know, whatever. No, I knew, okay, we knew that was from God. And I knew that if that was God's plan, and it was new, it's not like that anymore, thank God. We knew it was just going to be a season. When you take over a company, and you never went to school to take over a company, you never, you know, were trained in that area, he had to learn so much. So my job at home was to not fall apart, to not put demands on him. You need to be home. And that's not right. And da 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 da. And your kid doesn't even know you. And that wasn't my, would that help? No. That would just, we would have probably been divorced if I would have acted like that, right? I knew that he was, if I felt like, you know, man, this is, you know, not the pressure, but the change of season, how much more is he? He's the one running the company. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to pray for him. I'm going to pray for him. And we're just going to worship God here at home. And I know this is just a season. And you know what? We passed that test. We went from that time. I remember it wasn't easy because, you know, you put the kids to bed and then you're just quiet. And then midnight he gets home and stays up till like 3 a.m. And then the next day he's already gone before you get up. And, you know, it was a challenge, but I'm so thankful for what God taught me through that. He taught me peace. He taught me joy. He taught me how to get your eyes off of yourself, right? Yes, I love my husband, but I don't need. Now, we do need each other to fulfill the plan of God because God put us together. But for my household to run smoothly, if God is calling him somewhere during that time, you know, it was a season of learning things, then God will not just get me through it. Oh, man, we made it. But we're going to come out stronger at the end of this. Amen? I haven't even started. Okay, so now, okay, go to, hold on, where am I going? Why do I have this part here? Hebrews 11. Okay. Go to Genesis 12. Okay, and now let's look at, now I read his whole story here of Abraham, but we're not going to. It's very long. He goes through a lot. There's so much, but we're just going to read the beginning here. Starting with verse 1, it says, "Now the Lord said unto Abraham," Abram was his name at this moment, "get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed." So the very first thing that I noticed here and that God brought to my attention was the instruction. It started with an instruction. But also he had to be positioned. Why did he speak to Abraham? Do you ever wonder, why did he pick Abraham? 90, you know, however old he was at this moment. I don't think he was in his 90s yet. And Sarah, he picked a barren woman. Why not just pick a young, supple couple, you know, that just got married and, you know, newlyweds, and you would have gotten a baby much faster then, right? He picked what wouldn't seem like the best outcome. He picked someone that they've already been married for years. They're old. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to make anybody feel old if you're in their 70s, 80s. But they're not in their prime, right? I mean, I'm 37. And every time somebody asks me, are you going to have another baby? I'm like, I'm almost 40. Like, no. I'm not saying 40 is old if God wants you to have a baby at 40. But for me, I'm like, no. And could you imagine Sarah, 90, you're going to have a baby? He picked people that were not in their prime. And she was barren of all things. She'd been barren her whole life. She had never produced an heir for her husband. But yeah, let's pick them. They're going to be the father of many nations. Old and, you know, barren. But God knows what he's doing. So there is an instruction. Instruction will always come before manifestation, before a promise, however you want to put it, before the end result, before the home, before the car, if you want to get more technical, before anything, you will always receive an instruction. Every scripture in the Word that you read instructs us in one way or another. There, if you read, you test it tomorrow when you read your Word. Finish reading, but don't just stop and, oh, I feel good now. What did God speak to you through that, those scriptures or chapter, whatever you read, what is my instruction for today or for this week with what I read? And there will be one. Because if we're just reading the word to read it and we don't hear an instruction, I'm not saying an audible voice, but, you know, through the word of God, he'll instruct us, he'll guide us, he'll lead us, then we're not really doing much with the word. The word is to change us, right? To renew our minds. Well, we have to be instructed. So that's the first thing. Instruction came before the promise. God's instructions are always to get us to a place we're not currently in. When he's instructing us by his word, he's getting us, he's trying to get us somewhere that we're obviously not in. So when our pastor was ministering on Sunday morning and challenging us, I recognize that as there's somewhere God wants us as a congregation that we're not currently in, or he wouldn't be drawing us and challenging us and prompting us and prodding us, so to speak. And you know, there wouldn't be so much intensity in our pastor if we were already there. So there's a place that God is calling us to. God's instructions, it's not to keep us, but to take us. So that's why I said, when we read our word, if we just close it and said, okay, I feel good about myself, I read my word today, I got that crossed off, but that word didn't take us anywhere, we're still in the same depression, we're still in the same anxiety, stress, confusion, fear, doubt, whatever it is, anger, then we didn't allow the word, his instructions, to take us anywhere. We're going to stay here. Thank you, I read my word, but I'm going to stay here. Because it says, where does it say? Get thee out of thy country. In the Amplified, it just simply uses the word go. Go. So he's trying to get us somewhere, to take us somewhere, not to keep us. You know, as parents, we want our children to grow. We like them little. They're adorable. They're more cuter when they're little. It's obvious. They're just cuter when they're little. I mean, I don't go up to Kyra and go, oh my God, you're so, you know, she's older now. She's cute. She's beautiful. But, you know, when they're little and chunky and just so cute, it's, I don't know. Maybe I just love babies. They don't like me, though. So as cute as they are, we want them to grow, right? We want, you know, Julia to, you know, she talks, but we want her to, she's going to eventually speak better, clearer. You know, Lily, she's baking, but eventually I want her to make dinner. You know, be in charge of dinner. No, but we want our kids to grow. Well, it's the same thing with God. He's calling us to grow, calling us. So get thee out. When he said, get thee out, what is it that God is asking us to get out of? And for all of us, it's something, it may be something different, maybe something the same. Way of thinking, way of doing, way of living. He's just saying, you know what? Just get out. Just get out. We can't go where he wants us to go with the same way of thinking. That's why we renew our minds daily. We can't go where he wants us to go with the same way of living. We can't get a harvest, a financial harvest, whatever it is you're calling out, and still give the same. Everything requires more. It requires more. Faith led Abraham. Oh, I'm sorry. I already said. Faith led Abraham away from something and to something. So just like Abraham, we must be in a position to hear God's instruction. Now, when I say hear God's instruction, we are constantly hearing his instruction. We hear pastor's voice when he's preaching. We hear the voice of God when he's leading us and you know, those intimate moments, and he's speaking to us, son, daughter, this is what I need you to work on. And we hear him by way of the word of God. But here, let's go to Proverbs first. Proverbs 8:33. This is going to answer our question. So I know I relate a lot of things to parenting, but I'm with my kids all the time, and that's wonderful. I love it. So that's my illustration for pretty much everything. You know, sometimes I'll say something to Lily, hey, and Tomas can attest to this because when he's home, he recognizes it. Lily, I need you to take out the trash. Okay, I'll do it right now. But because kids are kids and their minds are going about 1,000 miles an hour and they're like, ooh, butterfly, you know, they're constantly thinking of what am I going to make? What am I going to do? Later never comes until I speak again. Lily, I said, take out the garbage. Oh, yeah, I forgot. And she comes, right? Or with Ethan, you know, did you brush your teeth? Yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm just making my bed. Well, he finishes his bed and again, oh, dinosaur on the floor. And then, you know, you forget. Kids forget. So they hear, right? They hear the instruction, but they're not doing anything with it, really, the first time at least, right? Sometimes you got to get a belt out and, okay, I'll do it, you know? But so let's read Proverbs 8:33, because this is what this reminds me of. Wait, one more page. Everybody's laughing, so I'm not the only one. It says, hear instruction and be wise and refuse it not. In the Amplified, heed, pay attention to instruction and be wise and do not ignore or neglect it. We hear the instruction, but then let's just pretend this is instruction. I'm very literal. I need things like I need to see things. This is obviously a piece of paper and instruction is not, you can't touch instruction, right? But let's just, if this is instruction and I heard instruction, it was given to me, I took it. Okay, I heard something. I can either lay it down, there's instruction, I heard something, and walk away from it. Or I can get instruction, hear instruction, and do something with instruction. Like Sunday morning's message, did we go home and not think about it in our mind, but let it, you know, kind of regurgitate in our spirit? Okay, more. There's more. It's not that God is saying, oh, you're not doing enough. God, you're challenging us big time. You have something in store. So what, and then we each, again, we're all in different phases of life, different levels. You, your own, yourself with your family. God, what is it that you want us to grow in, to go in more in? Pastor's talking about a church building. Show me my portion. I'll be obedient. Thank you for divine ideas. You know, I'm just throwing examples. I'm not saying that's what everybody, you know, is going to be saying or should have said. Oh, you should have said that. I'm just throwing things out. But it's what we're doing with that instruction. Because I can hear instruction and we hear it all the time. And then that was good. Thank you, God. I receive that. Because with every instruction, there's also an end result. Yes, you want more for us. Hallelujah. And we're going to have a new building. And oh, it's going to be so beautiful. But then we just forget about it. Or we don't do anything with it. Or we don't think that we have a part to play with. Play in it. We do. We each have a part. We were all called here. Thank God we were called here because we were rescued here. And that was God's purpose. He wanted to rescue us and change our lives. But he knew that you have something for this church, that you have a part to play for this church. So the proof of hearing, we can't allow our ears to become callous to the instructions of God. We can't just hear something and, oh, you know, I became callous. I don't know what to do with that, or you just forget about it. Now, number two, the first one was instruction. God's instructions are always to get us. No, instruction comes before the promise. Number two, the proof of hearing is in our obedience to what we hear. So we see in verse 4, if you go back to Genesis, that Abraham obeyed. He didn't ponder. It didn't say he worshiped. It didn't say he prayed. It said that he did exactly what God told him to do, which is to get out of his country, get away from his people. Not that his family, I mean, they worshiped other gods. They were doing things, but he loved his family just as much as you and I love our families. But God called him for more, two more. It says in verse 4, so Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him. It didn't say, so Abraham went into the wilderness to pray, went into the wilderness to, you know, sacrifice, to worship. He just simply did what God asked him to do. He departed just as the Lord had spoken. Amen? So we have to have those actions. And Pastor Nancy talked about that when she was here, about just go with what's right in your spirit. Something, you know, maybe there's a business, you know that you're called to business. What seems right? And I'm just paraphrasing everything that she said. Our pastors have said that you can't, we can't just keep on hearing and expect to arrive. There's going to be actions. And I know that it's not the best feeling to step out not knowing what's on the other side, but your knowing is the go. Just see it as, okay, God doesn't show you a screen of how everything's going to play out and, oh, this problem's going to arise, but this is how I'm going to take you out of it, because then we would be so comfortable. There'd be no faith in that. If I knew all the problems that would come up and God tell me this is how I'm going to get you out of this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, and then you're going to arrive here, okay, I'll go because you already told me everything. But God wants us to go, not that we're blind and we don't know anything and okay, sirrah, sirrah. That's not what I'm saying. We do, we go on a knowing, but it's not about having all your ducks in a row. Do you know what I'm saying? And I'll use our home for an example. This home that we just got into, I've maybe 2 years before we actually got into it, I started desiring more. And it's like Daniel says, you look around and you're like, this is nice, but it's not doing it anymore. I felt crammed, right? And not just that, I just knew there's another home for us. And then that's all it was. And through many ministers that would come, they'd give me a word about a home. What they said just bore witness with what God was already speaking to me. My pastors would ask me, are you guys looking for a house? Just here and there. And I'm like, well, yeah, not really, but, you know, I'd like another home. And so sometimes I'd go on, you know, the marketing place, Redfin, and just look at homes and nothing really, because I was not going to move out. I want to stay close. Nothing around us would really was really capturing my attention. My desire was, I'm one of those people, I can be happy anywhere. Anywhere, really. If it's a nice house, I can live in the mountains and the beach, or on the beach, not in the beach. See, English matters. I can be happy in any style home, not any style home, but there's a lot of styles that I like. I'm not very like, oh, it has to be like this. It's just a general, you know, idea, and then I just trust God with, you're going to show me. But I knew that I didn't want to, like a cookie cutter home anymore, like, what is that called, like a subdivision or a track homes, like where they build, you know, and they're all kind of like, they're the same. That's what we had the first time. Lovely home. It was good to us. We were good to it. We did so much to that house. But I knew I wanted an older home, even if it needed some upgrades. I was fine with that. I told Tomas, you're fine with that. And I wanted like an older neighborhood. All the houses are different, an older neighborhood. So one time I got on there and I saw a home close to the one that we moved into. And of course you get excited and you just I attacked that thing with faith. And we went to see it. It was beautiful, lovely. And the price, it made me nervous. I was like, oh, and it was less than what we paid for the one we have now. But this is where that stretch came. It was in the 400s. And I was like, oh, okay. We're going to go a little bit lower. Because in my mind, I'm thinking, man, that's not what this house is worth. Because we were used to the old market. And this is when the market started going up. Now the house would probably be worth more. And so we lowballed it. Long story short, we didn't get it, okay? We didn't get it. But before that, before we learned that we didn't get it, we packed. Because I threw everything at it. We're going to get in this house. We packed everything that we could pack without, you know, being too uncomfortable. Like, our clothes were still hung up. But, like, decor, books, you know, things like that, we packed. Because I was like, and what that did, long story short, because it's almost 8, it set me in motion. Like, okay, we didn't get that house, but you have a house for us, God, because I am not living out of boxes for more than, you know, a year. I'm not going to live out of boxes for a year, God. And I know you have a house for us. And it got me excited. Us going and stepping in that house got me to look at an older home. And, ooh, I do like this and I like that. And appreciate it more, you know, because you have an idea in your home, in your mind, and you don't really know it until you get into it. And it got me excited to where, okay, we didn't get that house, but I know there's another house for it. Now, there were other homes that we saw. We never put an offer in another home because I was like, no, nothing compares to that first one. It was just, you know, it was really, really nice. It still needed, like, upgrading, but it wasn't like I can't do a renovation where it's, like, stuck in the 1960s, but I can, like, update things to my liking. Does that make sense? Okay. So when this house came, it actually didn't go on the market. My realtor had talked to somebody. Anyway, it was so funny. The house, the first house we saw was on this street called Fur. We saw other houses. Then we saw another house on the next street, Frank, like right behind. It was literally the house right behind it. Lovely home, two-story home, big home. But the yard, it was literally you go out and it's a pool. Like there's no grass, nothing. And I needed a lawn. I need grass. I need flowers, you know. So I was like, no. And then the one right across the street, that's the one we ended up moving into. But how that happened is the girl, the woman, not the girl, the woman that grew up in that house with the pool, the two-story one, she was a realtor. And so my realtor had talked to her, and now she was selling the house across the street, you know, because they all know each other, these people. They all grew up there. So she's the daughter, you know. And she, Michelle, our realtor, had told her about us and stuff. You know, keep them in mind if something comes up. So anyway, this came up. We got to see it before it went, hopefully we don't get nobody in trouble, before it went live on the market. And I told him, I like it. This is it. Because it was the same, kind of the same floor plan as the first one, but bigger, like longer. The yard, this house was built on two lots, the house that we live in, so we had a lot more land, not land, we don't live out in the country, but more property. The grass was there. We can put a pool in, no big deal, you know, we can make that happen, or God will make that happen. But that I'm talking about this because that not knowing, because the what always kept me from actually going forward with the house was thinking, but we have to sell our house. How does that even work? You sell your house and then you buy a home. What if it doesn't go align at the perfect spot? You know, and what if we end up with two mortgages and, you know, all this stuff? It just seemed like a lot to even try. And so our realtor was really, you know, nice about it because we put our house on the market when we saw the first home. So our house had been on the market for several months. We already had offers. We had already accepted an offer, all of that, but we didn't have a house. So anyway, long story short, everything that, you know, things were thrown at us during that process. Shock and awe is like, oh, you know, I didn't know in California that a house that you paid $50,000 for in 19 whatever, now it's worth this much. You're going to pay that tax, not this tax. Your taxes increase to what you buy it for. Only in California. But that's okay because we get stretched. So that got thrown at us. Just different things. You know, he was really busy at work. It just seemed like in the natural, like, man, this is just too much. We had meetings and all kinds of stuff. This is just too much. And then the waiting period, escrow took like 45 days. But that ended up being a blessing because our buyers needed an extra, you know, extra time. And all just anyway, everything ended up literally the minute we got done taking out the last item of our home because we were already moving out. The minute we took out that last box or whatever it was the minute that the owners pulled up because it was getting so close. Like, hey, we need to get out because they needed to get out of their apartment. They, you know, their landlord's kicking them out. We can't get out because the lady's still moving. She's still there. We can't go and live with her, you know. And she's waiting because her carpet's not, you know. I'm like, I'll be nice to you. You lived your long life. You know, she's waiting for her other house to be renovated somewhat. And so it was like all this waiting, but it just worked out perfectly. We didn't know that when we signed papers, when we began the journey, it grew us. It challenged us. And what I see now is that everything that God stretches you in your personal life is not just for you. It resonates with the ministry, with your pastors, with the church. If we can't stretch for more for our homes, for our families, for, you know, our personal lives, how are we going to come with faith when pastor's trying to stretch us here or God is stretching us here? Because we're so used to our little, I'm so comfortable with my rent amount. You know, our mortgage tripled, quadrupled four times than what we were used to paying. It was so comfortable. We had all this money left over, like every month. But God stretched us. And now I see why. Now we come, you know, this year and God is stretching us more. And I see the pattern stretch, stretch, more, more. But not so you can do without, not so that you can have less, so that he can bring you into more as he brings the church into more, right? I'm not going to get done with this. Let me just see where I want to go, okay? Let's see. Okay, I'm going to go all the way this way. So faith, we know, comes by hearing, but it needs action to come to its fullness. We can't get stuck in the hearing. Our hearing eventually has to turn into actions, into acting. We have to take those steps of faith. Faith without works is dead. That's in James 2:26. You can go there yourself. So we can't just hear our way into the end result. The hearing is for receiving the instruction. So here we see Abraham heard, and then he departed. He obeyed. We walk by faith, not by sight. Go to 2 Corinthians. Well, actually, no, just write that down. We're not looking for outward agreement, only moving when it makes sense outwardly. And that's what I was talking about, making sure you're, you know, I got to make sure all my ducks are in a row and all my finances are straight before I start this business. You know, God's asking me to buy a home. Okay, let me make sure I have, you know, the down payment. Let me, you know, all the natural things that in the natural would make sense to have all organized. That's not what faith is. And not that faith is messy and unorganized, but faith needs your cooperation. And you know, the knowing, like people that need and I can be that way in the natural if I don't watch it. I like organization. I like, you know, I like knowing, you know, things are going to get paid. I like knowing, you know, that all this stuff is going to happen. But if we don't, if we just live by that, well, I got to, you know, this is how much I make. And okay, this is for this and this is for that. And this is all I have for the church. Then we're going to rob ourselves because knowing things, let's just call it knowing things as far as making sure every, you know, your ducks are in a row, can only take you so far. Faith can take you so much farther than all your ducks in a row, so to speak. Amen? We're also not moving or looking for our feelings to align or our feelings to cooperate. Faith dismisses emotions and feelings. It doesn't try to get rid of them. It just bypasses them. So in our faith journey, we're not going to be moved by how we feel. Well, I feel stretched. Good. Well, I feel uncomfortable. Good. Well, I feel offended. That's not good. But we don't want to walk by that. We don't want to just give in to that. Feelings change. You get up one morning, you feel beautiful. You wake up the next morning, you forgot to take your makeup off the day before, and you scare yourself in the mirror. I'm speaking from experience. I'm so diligent about taking off my makeup that when I don't, and I forget, and I look in the mirror, it's like, whoa, it's like mascara everywhere, and my blush and everything, eyeshadow. Because I, you know, you do it so diligently, and you forget. And it's like, holy moly, let's go wash that pillowcase. I can imagine what that looks like. So it dismisses emotions. You know, don't go by emotions. And our pastors have done a wonderful job of teaching us this. You can't go by emotions. If you do, it's going to rob you and it's going to get you into trouble if it's the wrong emotion, like anger, and you give into it. But, and you know, feelings and emotions. I like what they highlighted today for the Dufresne Ministry on their Instagram. You know how they do like little inserts of their message. And it was where she talked about... how does she word it? Pretty much you every problem can be fixed in just knowing who you are in Christ. And she talked about how those, you know, don't let the devil rob you or lie to you or ever let this thought just roll around in your mind about, I need to get away. I need to get away from all this. You know, this is just too much. I need to get away so I can find myself. Because... And then she said, go to Romans, Ephesians, 1 Corinthians, 2, you know, Galatians. You found yourself in Christ. And if we can remember that, I am who I am in Christ, even when my feelings don't feel like you're in Christ, right? That's where that condemnation comes. I know who I am in Christ. I know that I have authority in Christ, even though I just made a mistake 2 seconds ago and I asked God to forgive me, but my feelings are trying to make me feel less than, like I don't deserve this anymore. No, I know who I am in Christ. And so that was really good. So we don't, and it's not even trying to get rid of your emotions. That's energy wasted. Don't try to make yourself feel better. Just get the word in you. Just dive into the word, worship God, be led by how he, you know, has you go about this. And it's not, okay, I don't feel this. I don't feel this. I don't feel this. I'm not an angry person. I'm not a depressed person. I'm not this. I'm not that. I'm not in strife. I forgive. You know, that's just energy wasted. Just dismiss it. you're dismissed. I don't need to be guided by you. And that's freeing when you can act according to the word with faith actions, regardless of how you feel. Put that aside. Faith also worships. We see in verse 7 and 8 of Genesis 12 that Abraham, when he pitched his tent and all that, he built an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord, meaning he took time to worship. He heard, he obeyed, he wasn't yet there yet. Was he the father of many nations yet? No, he wasn't, but he took the time to worship. We have to be willing to worship God when the manifestation hasn't shown up in its natural form, because it's a way of honoring him. You acknowledge that you are trusting him, that he is faithful, and you're worshiping him as though it has already arrived, as if you've already, you know, arrived, because you know you will. And that's what Abraham did here. Part of worshiping is to make sure that our lips are not complaining. We can't worship and then complain. One, it's either one or the other. I mean, you can. You physically can worship today and then complain tomorrow morning. What I'm saying is you can't do those things collectively and expect to arrive at the end result for the, you know, what God has told you is yours, what belongs to you. Complaining is connected to an unrenewed mind. So that's the old man. The old man complained. We don't need to be the old man anymore. We're a new creation. Don't let your mouth take you back to the place that faith is bringing you out of. So we're all, like I said, all of our journeys are different. We're all, you know, on a faith journey. And he's brought us, all of us are somewhere further than where we were, let's say, last year, right? 1 year ago, a year ago. But if we, like, stop here, you know, things are coming up and the stretch and then your stuff at home that's going on and the kids and the job. I don't know. Maybe you're having stuff going on at your job place. And so all these pressures of life and you're in this place and then you let your mouth start going off. It's like you're allowing yourself to go back to the place that faith has taken you out of. Just from a simple act of complaining. And the devil tries to trick us into thinking it's going to feel better. By the time I'm done complaining, and I just want to tell my spouse the awful day I had and how awful my employer is and employee is or whatever, and I'll feel better. Okay, but let's go back to our feelings. Is it really our feelings that we're trying to pet here, that we're trying to grow? I'm not trying to grow my feelings, right? We're trying to grow our faith. So get into worship. If we get into worship rather than just spewing, you know, and I know it's easy to complain. I've been there, you know, your husband comes home, the kids didn't listen all day and or this happened, that broke, and you want to just, you know, spew it all out. Like, look at how awful my day was. But did it grow me in faith? No. Did it take me anywhere? No. So choose worship. Now, the next thing, we're almost done. Faith gets excited and familiar with what it's obtaining. Verse 17, 12, 17 says, and the Lord, let's see. Wait, why? Was it 17? No, that's not it. Anyway, it's where he tells him to go to the land that he's going to give him and scope it out and, you know, do all these things, kind of like take it in, research it. When God tells you something is yours, whether it's a home, we already know healing is ours. You know, maybe you have a business in your heart. Get excited. And that's going back to that, to the house, getting in that house, even though we didn't get that first house, it started something in us. It got the ball rolling. We got excited where we knew, okay, it's time. It's time. I don't know how everything's going to line up for it to happen where we sell our home at the right moment and buy that home because we don't want two mortgages. But it got to the point where when it was looking like it wasn't going to happen, I just said, you know what? If we have two mortgages, we have two mortgages. What are we going to do now? Oh, no, we're not going to do this anymore. No. If it comes to that point, fine. And I knew it wouldn't, but meaning I'm not going to forfeit something that God said says is mine out of fear of something that hasn't even happened. It's just a Reverend Stephen taught on this. I don't know when. I just quickly saw one of their messages. You know, fear is just projecting things that haven't even happened. It's just like a movie. You know, you watch a movie and it's pictures, but they're not your life, right? You don't go to bed afraid because that happened to that lady in that movie. That you know that's fake. You know that's not your life. Well, it's the same thing with fear and those thoughts. Well, what if you start that business? Or what if you buy that bakery or that building to start a bakery? Or you buy that home? And what if now you don't have enough? What if now you're going to live from paycheck to paycheck? And those are thoughts that he would try to, you know, the first 3 months of living in there, because we saw the stretch. I remember thinking, oh my goodness, this is PG&E is double. The water is double because I didn't think about, oh, big lawn, more water. And Tomas is not going to have a brown grass. Does J-Lo have a brown grass? That's from a movie. Anyway, you know these things. And the taxes that I was like, I don't know we had to pay these taxes. We got taxed on everything. I'm like, okay, praise the Lord. But I see, you know, because we responded correctly. We didn't freak out. What the devil was trying to say, oh, see, now you're not going to have enough. Now you're going to live from paycheck to paycheck. It's not true. Let me just tell you right now, we don't live from paycheck to paycheck. And that's what I'm saying. If you let him lie to you, you're just seeing that projection. And just because there's more on the stretch doesn't mean there's less than. And so now that we came out of, you know, he does more better with money. Like, it's just money. It'll come. Like, you know, don't worry. You don't ever have to worry about money. Because I was the one that used to worry about money. And because I'm the one that pays the bills and, you know, does the finances. But him, he's like, whatever, like, it's going to come. Like, we've never done without. So anyway, after like those 3 months of like that pressure of, oh, now you owe this tax bill. And oh, no, the water bill. And oh, look, PG&E, happy birthday and all this stuff. And all the lies of, oh, see, it's more. It's not just the mortgage that's more. It's everything. And I learned that just because we, just because there's more demands does not mean that we have less than. Does that make sense? And coming out of that, I realized it was all in my mind. It was all in my head. There's way more than enough. And I'm not just talking about a paycheck being more than enough. God has been so faithful, and we've been able to do things to the house. Can't see it because it's all things that you can't see. But this year, prayerfully, I told Tomas, can we do something that I can see, please? Like, can I get something inside? But, you know, he's the one that manages all that, and he knows the plumbing and the electrical. I'm just like, it's okay if the electricity is not working properly. Can we get a pretty chandelier? But, It's fun and it's exciting. And why did I share that about the house? Because I remember the feeling of uncertainty, like, oh, I don't know, is this going to work out? And then we got in, oh, it worked out, but oh my goodness, all these payments and the bills are so much more. And the minute that I rearranged my thinking, money flowed. It's us that keep things from flowing, our mentality. So relating that now, I can kind of relate that to what we're, as a church, being challenged with. If I think, oh man, pastor's talking about a building, holy moly, I don't know. I was just thinking of doing my kitchen. There goes my kitchen. There goes my floors. Oh my goodness, a building? I mean, a building is a building. It's at least $5 million, right? And there's 1, 2, 3, 4. If you start doing that, let's see, 5 million divided by 50. Oh man, they don't have it. They don't, oh my goodness, how are we going to, okay. No, the stretch for more, the stretch is to contain more. And if God is challenging us that, if we can renew our minds daily, and if we can practice at home, because like I said, whatever, however you handle things at home, the challenges, the extra bills, the taxes, all of that, you're going to bring that same mentality here. So that's what God taught me. How you're thinking about your home is how you're going to think about the church, the vision. So stop that. You're not doing without. You're not living from paycheck to paycheck. I didn't bring you in this home so you can just live here. And you know, this is your heart's desire. You wanted this. I gave it to you. He spoke to me some personal things, but now I bring that mentality here. Yes, Pastor, you want a new building? No problem, because God told you. And if God put that in your heart, and we're the people in the church, this is our church too, then we have a part to play. And yes, it's going to require more. Obviously, it's not just, okay, I'll pray more. I'll paint the building, Pastor. That's how I'll succeed. No, I know that he's challenging all of us for more. And so if we can bring that mentality, if we can bring that excitement, because it is exciting. It's not a time to mourn, like, oh, man, we're going to be busy, and look at the stretch. It's an exciting time. Capture the heart of God, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Capture the heart of God, and don't let Satan, the devil, a fallen angel, rob you from the joy that is that journey, because it is a joy. I look back to when we lived in an apartment, had no food, didn't even have maple syrup. Not real maple syrup. Dear God, I would not have bought real maple syrup back then. But, you know, like Aunt Jemima, but the off-brand one, we didn't have that. And I remember he said, let's make pancakes. And it was the kind that needed eggs. That was the one time I broke down. I remember, because we were hungry. What can we eat? I think the potatoes had ran out. We found a pancake mix. It needed eggs. I was like, why did I get that one? Why didn't I just get the one just add water? Just add water and needed eggs. Did we have money for eggs? No. He didn't. We were living from paycheck to paycheck, like just enough. And I remember no syrup, no egg. There goes my pancake. And I think I cried that day. And he's like, Selene, it's going to be okay. He was a strong one. He came to me, he hugged me, he goes, it's going to be okay. It's not going to be like this forever. I was like, okay. And then I see it now. And I don't look at that and, you know, I didn't let Satan rob us of the joy that part of the journey had, right? It's not fun not having food. I'm not saying go hungry, have fun. No, it's not fun, but we didn't go hungry. Something, the next day, something, I just know we never went hungry, right? I know I was skinnier back then, but it wasn't because I'm a lot plumper now. Maybe it's because of overflow. No. But we never went without. And so see how God works. See how he's worked before he brought you out of point A to point B, point C. Maybe you had a delay. Abraham had a delay, did he not? Ishmael, a good delay. He had fun with that delay. he had a delay, but did he still arrive at the end result? Did he still arrive? Yes, he did. So don't let your delays speak to you. Those delays are in the past. Move forward. Move forward. Amen? And so that is all I have tonight. I know I kind of felt like I was all over the place. Let's go ahead and stand. Amen. Our pastors will be back on Sunday. If you're not watching the meetings, they've been so good so far. Make sure you're watching them. And so, Father, we thank you for tonight. We thank you, God, for giving us a pastor that hears from you. And we thank you that you are challenging us, you are stretching us, because you have more for us, more for our lives, our personal lives, our family, our businesses. But Father, you have more for this city. You brought this church, you brought our pastors here to change the city, and we are a part of that, Father. Thank you, Lord, for the honor and the privilege that it is to be a partaker, a vision runner, Father. We thank you for that, Lord. And we refuse to handle the challenge in the mental realm. We refuse to handle the challenge in our flesh with what we can accomplish, with what we can bring out of natural resources. And Father, we move in your plan fully, full of faith, full of joy, full of peace, Father, because you are a faithful God, and we are excited to be the ones ones that get to be a part of the new building phase, that we get to be the ones that see it from the beginning to the end. Oh, Father, we know that there is an end to that, and we see it. We get excited every day. Father, we imagine that building. We know that it's not our vision. We may not know how it's going to look. Our pastor knows. But Father, we join in with our faith and with our assignment. And Lord, we guard against strife. We guard against offense toward one another, because we know that nothing would hinder this project and this year more than getting into offense with one another. And so Lord, any offense, any bitterness, any act or thought of darkness, we lay it down, Lord, that you would show us that if we're speaking ill against one another, if we are complaining about our tasks in the local church, Father, that we be quick to correct that so that we can flow in unity and in one accord, because you have a plan, Lord, and we want to be a part of that plan. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.